Hello, Fleet Activities Yokosuka, Keigo, Nagishi, those 35 families who live in Nagishi still. Out there on YouTube, I'm Captain Dave Glenister. With me today, our very special guest, Mr. Jim O'Donnell. He's the Assistant Public Affairs Officer at Fleet Activities Yokosuka. So, in addition to the production of this little show, if you have any comments or questions or complaints about the sound, you may direct it towards Jim. But also, those kind of things like our Facebook page and our website and the base commander's channel and all that information that tends to flow out of here whenever we have typhoons or base closures or all those things, things happen. It all falls into public affairs. And Jim is at the heart of all those things. We're very happy to have him with us, you know, on the base. Comes with a whole career's worth of public affairs kind of information. And happy to have you on the show here. We'll go through a few things and here to add comment and to take down some comments that I make, because it's kind of an out-of-body experience for me when I'm speaking up here. I don't even know what I say. So we'll get to it here in just a second. We have Spring Festival coming up on the 29th of March. Usually get between 40 and 60,000 people that come on the base, depending on the weather. Last year, weather was a bit rainy. But this is a big cultural event. Please come out and support that. And by that, I mean you want to get out there and experience the cherry blossoms. That's how it actually started. We got these cherry blossoms on base, and we want to open it up to the public who doesn't get a chance to see the base often. And they are here to see America and interact with us. So obviously you are the Americans they're here to interact with. So please come on out there. With regard to the ice comments, very often people do not leave their contact information. And sometimes that's okay. But you won't get a response because sometimes. So I try to, not specific to the military, but in general, we like to praise in public and we correct in private is usually how you want to go. So sometimes if there are comments out there that say that, you know, you asked for cheddar and you got, Munster cheese on your something or other, I'm probably not going to call that out because that seems to be a one-person attitudinal adjustment. But systemic things will address.
Not a lot of Gouda fans out there.
There's not. Strong cheese. It's a strong cheese. Put those things in there. But add your contact information. I never really call you out on this thing. But we may need to have some follow-ups there. So with that, we'll head right into it here. First up, Club Alliance. And this is about the Valentine's Day dinner. You really outdid yourselves this year. We're very impressed with everything from the entrance, the service, the staff, our table, the environment, especially the 7-course meal. Created a great environment. And so we passed on to Godfrey Johnson, the manager, all that positive feedback. People want to do it again next year.
Those dinners, those really help the people that actually work there. When you get these kind of positive comments, it actually will help improve the service. You know, obviously, yeah, you want to tell them when you've gotten customer service that was maybe not up to par, but when you give them these good positive feedbacks, it really does help with the quality and the morale of the actual workers that are there.
And as a leadership point, when you have people in your organization that are not doing so great, it is a lot easier to point to that person and saying, hey, great job to you, Mr. X, and then everyone else will see that and say, that is now the standard we want to do. So you're making everyone's job easier by doing these things, which is great, so appreciate that. The next one's from the auto services. Specific to the auto parts services they received, this was on the 19th of February. My car battery died unexpectedly with my husband out of town. Thankfully, a friend helped jump my car and I drove to the auto port. The gentlemen were able to help me in a time-sensitive, I only had an hour before to pick up the kids, in professional manner. Front desk staff and the supervisor were on the ball and eager to provide outstanding service. So thank you for your feedback using the ICE system, and we've had these kind of comments before, and they'd say that's their job, but they did a good job. But I also want to read some of the comments that Mr. Dan Kovan put in here, which is, we're happy to hear the next, thank you for the ICE comment, and continues the ICE system. We're happy to hear that our next care center was able to help you, but for future feedback, you may also want to visit www.mynavyexchange.com and take the survey. Give some feedback there as well, and when you do that, you're entered to win a $250 gift card. You could be drawn from a lottery and get that. So, and it's good for them to hear this feedback as well. And that's for a lot of things. The types of beer that we serve, because we don't have these massive warehouses, we get a lot of feedback. That's a good place to give feedback as well.
Yeah, they're not going to, if there's something that you like from the NEX Autoport to the exchange to commissary, you know, if something you need, they can't read our minds. So go ahead and fill out those comment cards, go onto the website and fill out the things, and they'll get it if they can get it.
Yeah, and so the demand signal back in the States, you get these massive warehouses, and they can stock everything. So based on how fast you buy it, they get this feedback. Well, we don't have that same ability here. We kind of get it, and when it's out of stock, it's out of stock. So like Jim said, fill these out, and they'll try it. Sometimes, you know, you may be the only person asking for a particular type of motor oil. We've had those comments, or a particular type of craft beer or something, and they'll stock it and see how it does. But by all means, yeah, keep the feedback coming. Here's one for the optical shop. Actually, we'll do the optical shop in a second here. This comment's for the embassy. This really went to PSD. We've talked about this before. It's about passports. It's about services. The comments for the embassy and those who made the arrangements for them to come on base for passports, the service was exceptional, friendly, supportive. It saved the day of work as well as school for my kids and the cost of stress of finding the embassy in Tokyo. Taishkan is the Japanese word for embassy. America Taishkan, that's how you'd find it. Not that hard, really, but point taken. So sometimes the embassy folks come down when they have something else to do, particularly like a naturalization ceremony or something. They'll bring some staff down, and they only have several hundred appointments. We have 15,000 people here who might need a passport for whatever reason. But I want to draw attention again and say, with enough time, you don't have to go to the embassy. You can apply for a tourist passport, or certainly renew your tourist passport by mail, like everybody else. Use your Japanese address, which you have. Okay, post office tells you how to get that. And give yourself enough time, mail off the documentation with the photos. You can get those taken at PSD as a photo booth and get all that stuff back. PSD, military, no fee passport. Embassy, and all your other places in America, that is your tourist passport. You want to have both. So you don't have to go to the embassy. That is a way to get it very fast, okay? But give yourself enough time, like everything else. And in Japan, that is my experience. As you might notice, I am not a buy off the rack kind of individual here in Japan. So most of the things that I buy would be clothes, come from the next. Actually, a good place to go, if you're ever up at the new Sano, if you need to buy a suit, jacket type of stuff, but shoes, running shoes and those type of things. You know, once you're over 220 pounds, there's very few shoes you can actually run with without damaging yourself. And you just got to buy online, and you got to get it. If it doesn't fit, you send it back. This lead time, that's part of living here in Japan. Give yourself some lead time. Halloween costumes, you got to order those 6 weeks in advance. So it's just part of living over here. And we don't have the instant gratification of the Facebook culture when we do our shopping here in Japan, but that's part of the experience.
Yeah, Amazon Prime was my very dear friend back in the States, but it's still good having it here in Japan. However, that two-day turnaround for a video game or that two-day turnaround for a pair of shoes, just not going to happen. You're looking at 6 to 7 days.
And, yeah.
One of the things I also wanted to go when Captain was talking about the passports, it says photos. You can get them over at the PSD office. Well, one of the things I also learned is you can go online on the websites online. They actually give you really simple instructions. And now in these days with the cell phones, and you can actually shoot them yourself. And there's sites that you can pay for that'll give you, okay, you need to work on this one better, or you can get them done yourself. So you don't really have to go through that photo booth or pay some gentleman out in town 1,500 yen for a photo to be done. You can a lot of times get them done in your house, you know, and just go ahead and print them out.
You know, I'm surprised they don't have to do that like with a webcam on one of these sites. You think someone would come up with that where you just kind of sit in front and see if it meets the spec.
Well, with my computer I had at home, I just sat in front of my computer, I snapped a picture, and then it, you know, you just tell it to go where we
Photoshop it and make yourself younger. Yeah, exactly.
or older,
as the case may be. No, just kidding on that thing. But to our last point, now we'll talk about the optical shop. I stopped by the optical shop to see if I could replace some frames. And sometimes you want to replace your frames with the past ones. Sometimes it's time to update. You know, styles change a little bit. I originally bought the frames at the next stateside. And so there's a little bit of customer service issue here, and I think a little bit of lack of understanding into what was going on. So the person went into the optical shop and said they got these frames 3 to 5 years ago back in the States. Can you look them up? And the person said, no, I can't. And I think that the customer was getting irritated, thinking the person did not want to help them. But the fact is that there's no master database that integrates the optical shops back in the States, like your prescription and the database of what you bought, with the ones now. I know for contact lenses, they won't even ship them. They won't make new ones unless you have a prescription that's up to date. I think lenses are a little different. But they couldn't do that, right? So they didn't look up your records because it was not possible. And so I'm sorry to inform you that we are currently do not have a record system of any kind that is linked to the records taken in the U.S. Next Vision Centers, which is why we were not able to provide the information you requested. And there were some flowers in the way. It was Valentine's Day. You imagine, that whole part of the shop, there's a lot between the balloons, the stuffed whatevers, stuffed bears holding hearts, and all those other things. That's kind of a busy part of the Next complex over there, which is also another way entrance into the beauty shop, right past the frames thing. But the reason for the 4-week time frame is that they ship the frames to Hawaii to cut the lenses. Now, this is, I'm not trying to undercut the Next, but there is plenty of opportunity, and once you get your prescription, to go out in town. That's where my boy gets his lenses, because, you know, he goes through quite a few, playing sports and everything else, pops, and of course, styles change much faster when you're a teenager. So we go through quite a few glasses and lenses, and they are cheaper and they are faster out in town. So you should feel free to explore and do your comparison shopping. I'm not trying to advertise from one or the other. Your situations are always unique. But feel free. They are good lenses, good frames out in town.
Mm-hmm. As a glasses wearer, as obviously you can tell, I've been wearing glasses since I was 5, and I remember the hassle of going through getting glasses as my dad when I was growing up, and I went through many, many frames as a soccer player and everything else. However, my son, unfortunately, he downloaded my genes for my great myopic eyes. And we went by, just drove right by one of the eyeglass frame places right out there off 16.
Yep.
And we were in and out within an hour, and we didn't even have a prescription. They just kind of put them on the little machine, and he was good and gone, and fairly cheap.
Yeah. So if you need lenses to correct your vision, you don't even need to go to get a full-on appointment, right? You can go do these things. I did that in Osan Air Base. Mm-hmm. There's one out there. And without even speaking a word of English, I got everything taken care of. It was awesome. But, I mean, obviously you want to go to get your eye appointment because they check more than your prescription, right? They check for the health of your eyes. But if you just need to get that, yeah, you can have it all one-stop shopping out there. So anyway, I encourage you to kind of explore that. Chapel of Hope. Sometimes we get comments on them, sometimes not. The chapel's reservation procedure for the Community Readiness Center. So the Community Readiness Center, as you know, right across from the commissary area, is that, you know, 4 floors of, you know, all the different services. But there's also rooms that you can rent. You don't pay rent, but you can reserve, right? Some are dual use. So we do, some of the classrooms and things are used during the week. And then on the weekends, you can borrow them, stuff like that. So that's what that's related to. The chapel itself, actually, sometimes, on certain conditions, certain commands, can use that as well. Everyone over there. The representative of the chapel staff informed my organization they could not let us know if the space was available and that it would have to come in physically inquire in person to reserve it. I was told this policy was in place because in between the time I asked on the phone and the time I arrived to make the reservation, someone might snake your room, is the bottom line, right? And which why you had to do that in person. So it could become booked. And they said, well, I'll take that risk. Yeah, this seems like seems absurd. And I believe that the chapel leadership agrees with you. This is absurd. So yeah, they're going to change that thing. So you do have to make your reservation in person. And that's because you have to sign some things to make sure you're actually going to show up. You know, it's always bad when someone reserves a room and doesn't use it. But yeah, I don't see a downside to them saying, hey, as of right now, this is what we have available. I kind of compare it to like a used car lot. Say, yep, we got plenty of Lexuses right now. I'm looking at a black one right now. But until you get down there and buy it, hey, all they're doing is telling you it's available. So, yeah, I agree with you. We are going to make sure we change this thing. You should not have to show up at the chapel just to ask what they got available for rooms. They should be able to tell you. You will have to go down there. So, good comment. I appreciate the comment, and we're going to take that one for action. So there you go. You've asked, we've answered, and we're ready to move on. Safety program. I won't tell you the apartment number, but over on 4th Avenue, the adjacent towers, they moved into a place over on 4th Avenue, and the adjacent towers have compressors fenced with bare wire that I believe, maybe barbed wire, but I'm not sure, but it says bared wire, which I feel is dangerously close to the backyards and playgrounds. One of the small rocker slides is only a few feet away. Perhaps you can cover these up with some landscaping, or please look into this. And like most of your comments, our department head, this thing, the safety director, Mr. Odie Smith, has answered in person. Based on the comments provided below, I've dispatched a safety inspector to evaluate the area and have the following recommendations. Now, what they do with these recommendations, sometimes these things cost money, and so there's pros and cons to all these potentially good ideas. Install higher fence around the existing fence to cover the entire tank. Install a fence around the playground area. Relocate the spring rock close to the play equipment, and all these different things. So they're looking at that. The Fleet Activity Safety Office will work with housing and facilities to rectify this issue. So they concur that there is a safety issue there, and we'll look at addressing that. So we actually had last typhoon season a boulder roll down the hill and impact this big fence. And so we had to take care of those things. Many of the things that safety has to worry about. But there are a few hands in this pie, and we'll take care of that. So you asked, and calling our attention to some of these things. We're a pretty big enterprise. A lot of things going on the base. And so you telling us that there's a safety concern, there is an abandoned vehicle, there's an abandoned bicycle, these are good things, and we take care of them. So, all right, this is going to Traffic and Safety Court. My concern regarding personnel getting tickets from the rear parking area between Nanaban and Hachiban Towers. I understand it is a no parking area, but I always see two white government vehicles parked there overnight, and it's telling me if government vehicles can park there, then POVs can park there too. Okay, that's the wrong lesson to take from this. All right, just so you know, don't connect dots that aren't there. Okay, I don't see any difference in these. Well, you should see a difference between a GOV and a POV because the rules are slightly different. However, in this case, you know, we're going to work with housing and identify the government vehicles that are in question, and we will ticket those, shake them down. If they're in violation, we'll take care of them. So, but you should not by no means read, hey, there's, you know, someone else, how many, you know, all the other kids were jumping off the bridge. Okay, don't do that. So, yeah, but sometimes some of these vehicles are parked in some strange places. Some people have vehicles that are permanently assigned to them. Yeah, they kind of check them out, they're long-term kind of vehicles. And they park them around their own grounds, and they have permission to do that. You know, they park them on their own curbs and things. And I don't give any particular examples. Excuse me. But yes, so if you see someone violating, whether a GOV or not, then call dispatch 243-5000, right? And we'll send someone over there and take a look and see what's, particularly if it's blocking a fire lane or a safety lane, these things will handle right away. Otherwise, we may send a note to the command saying, you know, you keep parking your vehicle there and you'll be down one GOV, just won't have one. But just because you see someone else breaking the rules, don't do it. Okay, this one's kind of of interest to some folks. I would recommend, this is for the gate guards, I recommend vehicles entering the base with a guest inside the vehicle should park or have a location to process their day pass so not to stop the traffic flow. Yeah, I totally agree. And unfortunately, we just don't have this kind of real estate that we can modify. You know, back in the States where we actually have a certain amount of control of where we can move our fence line, most of the time your pass and decal is outside the installation. There's like a turnaround area or something where you do that. Our footprint with the city of Yokosuka, it's a little more sensitive than that. We are contained, the whole installation. And we don't have enough room to just kind of have this now turn around another couple hundred yards between the big barrier that pops up and stops you and those things. So we do regret the inconvenience that you encounter in this installation. So, I mean, this has happened to me, too, in my official vehicle, where someone stops, and out comes the clipboard, they fill out the form. And we'll take a look at these things, particularly in high traffic volume times. But ideally, if you're coming here with a guest, please, you can actually Google. If you Google Yokosuka ISO or CIFE ISO, you will come up with the Industrial Security Office website. It has all the forms. You can pre-register your guests. You can do all these things, but do your homework and know what's coming.
Forms out, fill them out, have them ready to go. A lot of times, you know, most of the people aren't just, you know, picking someone up, hopefully not just picking someone up and bringing them on the base. They're actually having a little bit of pre-planning involved. So just taking the time to do some of that pre-planning can prevent a lot of this kind of this hurdle or this kind of slowdown.
And if you have someone that you bring on base as a guest, whether it be your girlfriend or it be one of your students, if you have a lot of folks who teach English classes or cooking classes, or you just have a friend that likes to come on that you know from out in town. If you're going to bring them on more than a couple times a year, there is a pass you can get, which is a laminated pass, which means as long as you're escorted, you show your ID card with their pass and you just move on in. There's nothing to sign or anything else. It's kind of like it takes a little bit longer. It takes maybe 15 minutes to get this pass in the ISO office, but then you're good for a year. And you never have to do any of the paper side and print out stuff again, because your name's on this thing. So consider getting that kind of daily pass where you can keep bringing them on. And that makes it even faster. Okay, so good stuff there. Kind of helps speed this kind of stuff up. Okay. Here's for ITT. The staff were very helpful. Tour guides, Mount Fuji winter sightseeing, Gotemba illumination were extremely informative. This is about the tours that you get when you go on these things. Recommend Wi-Fi service in MWR buses, especially 2+ hour trips to help tour participants research about the area being visited. Well, a couple things. One is you probably want to do your research before you go. But two, no, we're not going to install Wi-Fi on the buses. But what I do recommend, a lot of times on your phone, you can make your phone a hotspot, okay? And then you can get your iPad going, because the iPads and iPhones and those things are a little bit better device for output. They can actually put through these sites better. There's also the MiFi, M-I-F-I, kind of like a MiFi walker type thing, which you can add to your phone plan if you have your phone out in town. And that is all it is a hotspot. And you can have different service plans for that. And there you go. You can actually have a bunch of users and subscribers or whatever. So maybe we could say, hey, maybe we should buy a bunch of these for MWR or something. I'm not sure I'm inclined to do that, only because it's a little tougher to control, bandwidth and those other things. Roger, what you're saying, it is good to be on your phone and surfing these things, but there are other options. And I'm sure we're going to have an AmeriCable comment in this thing before the end of the show, and we'll be good. So we'll probably last comment before we got to take a break here. This is from our housing office out of the CAGO. Now, as you know, we have expanded. We started letting dogs into the first floor of some of the towers. And I did this because I want to see what the comments are. It is not like this has never been tried. It's been tried and rescinded, not here, but other places in Japan, other places around the world, because of hygiene, noise, people trashing the apartments. I mean, the dogs are running around. So I want to kind of get some feedback. And most of the feedback that I've gotten is, actually one person says she was very upset about it because she had told her young daughter that the only reason we're not getting a dog is because they won't let them in towers. And then I started letting dogs in towers, and she said, now what do I do? Because she was not really keen on having a pet here in Japan. But the comment is this one. So I expanded that to now 3 towers, I think. There's a couple over in the CAGO that we're expanding to. Just the first floor, though. Okay, just the first floor. I think small dogs should be allowed on all floors and towers with 4 exclamation points, especially if I'm stuck living in a tower for consecutive orders. Another 4 exclamation points. Well, it is what it is when you come to your housing assignment, and it takes me $7,000 to change occupancy, so that's why I'm not going to move you consecutive orders. However, here's the answer. While there is consideration for expanding authorization to allow dogs in other Ikego towers, there are no plans at this time to include this authorization to quarters above the ground floor, regardless of the size. Experience from these activities, so some folks have tried it, as I have alluded to, and I won't tell you what military service, not Navy, did this. Experience from other activities has shown that although we cannot eliminate all the potential problems associated with dogs and towers, we can mitigate many of the concerns by limiting to the first floor. And what we're talking about is the dogs urinate, defecate, can't make it outside in time doing the elevators, and people will swear up and down, I'm on the second floor and I'll use the stairs. I am telling you, they won't. That we will have problems. I'm going to mention this anyway. We had problems with human beings who couldn't make it to the bathroom in time in the tower stairwells. I'm not going to put people through that. But I also don't have a limitation on the size of dogs, because I don't have a size limitation in the houses. Why would I do it in the apartment? So first floor, that way, the probability of you making it outside in time is minimal. The probability of the dogs having an issue in the elevators is minimal, because they shouldn't be in there anyway, and that's why we do that. So we're not going to expand it to everybody. Say, what's the difference between a dog and a cat? Well, in my opinion, you can leave a cat for 4 days with enough food, water, and a litter box, and you don't have a problem, although they will be mad at you when you come home. Leave them for a day, they'll be happy to see you. Leave them for more than that, they're mad at you. But you can't do that with a dog. So with that, I think we're going to take a break here, and we'll come back with some more of your ICE comments.
Japan Road Tax season is upon us, and Yokosuka's VRO wants to make the process easy for you. Kanagawa Tax Reps and VRO staff will be at the Fleet Theater on March 20th, 23rd, and 24th, and April 20th, 21st, and 22nd from 9 a.m. to noon, and again from 1 p.m. to 3:30 to assist you. All vehicle decals must be replaced by June 1st to avoid any issues. So be sure to take advantage of this all-in-one service and stay up to date on your road tax.
Welcome back, Fleet Activities Yokosuka, Keigo Nagishi, Parts Unknown, Captain Dave Glenister, and Jim O'Donnell from CFA Public Affairs, here to take your ice comments, give you some constructive feedback, maybe some funny, sarcastic feedback, but hopefully all of it is useful to you one way or the other. Here's one for the gas station. We went to the gas station to turn in a propane gas tank. I'm going to correct the grammar on the fly as I go here. But basically this person bought these tanks, two tanks, like a year ago, thinking they could just turn them in when they're done with them. Well, you can turn them in, but you don't get your money back. All right? And they're upset by this. And so part of the reason is there's a certain shelf life on these tanks. You don't just get to turn them in because they're pressure tested and there's safety involved. I think it's 12 years is what the answer was. And the person says, so the next takes my tank back, gives me nothing, after they made me buy it, and now they can resell it. Well, they can't resell it. They have to actually redo stuff, too. So, and this is a very quick comment. Basically, I mean, it kind of came in very quickly here before this was printed, so there's no comment. But I will tell you this. You go to Yokosuka Resale, people PCS, they unload their tanks all the time. I've got like four tanks because I have like two patio heaters and a gas grill. It is nothing worse than running out of gas when you're in the middle of a barbecue. So I have a couple of these tanks, and what am I going to do with them? I'm going to leave them for somebody, put them on Yokosuka Resale, well, someone else will use them. But no, this is not a rotating thing. Back in the States, you buy a tank, you own the tank, that's your tank. And we're not going to buy it back from you, that's your tank. So I think it's unreasonable to have expected that. But good news, if you're looking for propane tanks, I've never found a shortage of people who are trying to unload those tanks. Right, and so you can turn them into, I think you turn them into NAVFAC recycling and other things. They have some gas in them when you go, but because they have to be purged. And for $30 to buy a tank, people almost don't want to spend the money to have them purged and then sent back. When you buy a new tank, when you PCS somewhere. So anyway, no, we're not going to buy your tanks back, but there are plenty of opportunities to get a free tank.
Yeah, the those websites that are out there, the Facebook pages that are out there that have those. There's opportunities for you to place your stuff up for sale or even just to donate it. A lot of people, when they're cleaning out their rooms, their apartments, their houses, they have all those chemical cleaning stuff, and it costs money to dispose of that stuff through the Yokosuka system. And, you can pick up a bottle of Kleenex a bottle of Kleenex spray, and you get the stuff you don't have to worry about throwing away or just to hold.
Maybe we should advertise that a little bit better with the new folks that arrive here. Because, I have chemical cleaners, mops, and vacuum cleaners. I leave them after your stuff's gone, you got to clean your place to get your deposit back. And then you show up somewhere else before your stuff's there and you got nothing. So maybe we should kind of push that at, I'm not sure, AOB or something. But certainly with new folks that arrive, maybe at housing or something, we can take a note on that and say of all the different things we have here, check out this website if you need a broom, a mop, some cleaning supplies. Yeah. That might be a good one to take for action.
Yeah, I know for my express shipment, I have my vacuum cleaner for my express shipment. I have my vacuum cleaner for my regular shipment.
You do.
And you just have to clean
it. You do. You absolutely do. All right, here's one for Ikego. I live in Asuka Tower. We're having an ongoing problem with people leaving their unwanted items in the lobby. Okay.
Almost for curtails to our thing.
Isn't it? Yeah. So, and some of those things, old clothing, old toys, partially eaten and new food items. Odd, I would say. Poisonous household chemicals, including open boxes of dishwashing detergent and capsules, and broken lamps, televisions. What can we do to stop this? I'm also concerned the food and household chemicals being left on the floor, and we have many children in the building. This is dangerous. You are absolutely right. So here's what housing's answer before I get to my answer. Our Keigo housing inspectors have been directed to enforce the housing regulations, continue giving tickets to the residents who are in violation. The residents who won't correct the problems will be given a letter of warning stating that military family housing termination could occur. No, I will. I will terminate your housing, and you will not have OHA. And you can find your way in life. Housing is a privilege. Those of you who think that, I'm stuck here, how would you like to be stuck here with no house and no money for a house? You abuse my houses, and you're out of here. It is that simple. So if you find someone who's putting our children at risk by leaving broken televisions and this stuff, you turn them in and they're gone. I'm not going to put up with it. It is that simple. Is that clear?
That's pretty clear.
That's pretty clear. In fact, going back, when I was here last time, and I lived in Okego as an 04, and the CO would get on Commander's Corner and talk about these things, he didn't talk about like the civilian administrative forum. That's where, you know, civilians fall under the military rules as well. When people are debarred, they are removed from the base, they're no longer allowed to come here. Well, he didn't do that, really. But what he would do, because if you break the rules, one of the options is to terminate their family housing assignment. And that's what he would do. He wouldn't debar them from the base. Like if you did drunk driving, DUI or something, he would just remove your family housing and your OHA. And by, you know, if you want to stay, stay on your own, but then people would go back. And it is, I'm telling you right now, that is totally legit in the scenic instruction. It is totally within the power of the installation CO, and I haven't done that. There are some cases I've contemplated it, particularly for dangerous people, you know, people who have assaulted someone else or something, but I haven't, because usually those things have been so severe that they've usually been gone anyway. But anyway, yeah, I can do it, and I will, especially if I think you're putting other people at risk. So help me catch these people, and I will help you with your problem.
An off-base house rental, anywhere $2,000 to $3,000 a month for a three-bedroom, then that's not even talking about the move-in housing allowances that you're going to have to pay to move in. You're looking at a pretty long commute if you're going to try to find some place that you think you can pay for out of your own pocket and
yeah.
to live off-base.
That's right.
Your job here.
That's right. So consider it. All right. Here's one. I won't give the restaurant, but it's a pizza establishment. We have a bunch of those on base. All right. And because this is just a general comment. So I order a large pepperoni pizza, and instead of making one, the staff pepperoni from scratch, there was already a cheese pizza, and they put pepperoni on it and ran it through the machine again. Now, back in New York, that's very popular to do that, because somehow the ability to soak up the pizza grease is what makes it special or something. And they probably assumed, that you wanted it quick, but you would have been happy with a brand new pizza, and they should have made a new pizza. So the comments from the pizza establishment, as for the pizza, the order taking should have made the pizza fresh. That is true. And if you had really wanted the cheese pizza, then recycled the pepperoni on it, you could have asked for that. And some people do, because they want it right now. And then doing a reheat, usually we do that for slices for customers in the line. So yes, should have had a fresh pizza. And if you wanted one, I'm sure they'll accommodate you. Say, hey, can I have that cheese pizza with some pepperoni on it? Because I'm in a hurry. They would have. But you should have had a fresh one. The other part of this was, which is the larger context, we're not all here to talk about pizza, is they didn't have large pizza boxes. And you know, you said, hey, I find it hard to believe that a pizza restaurant has no pizza boxes. Well, in this particular case, the West Coast port shipping slowdown, it's not a strike, because if they were on strike, they wouldn't get paid. So they kind of started, the stevedores, longshoremen, and those folks doing the West Coast kind of slowed down, kind of slow rolled things. And yeah, there actually were no pizza boxes. Now that has actually been, I wouldn't say resolved, I don't think there's anything signed yet, but there's been an agreement and things are moving again. But it may take several months to get all of the stock levels back to where they were because of all this stuff. So yeah, they actually had no pizza boxes, as luck would have it. So they gave you single boxes, but so hopefully it wasn't too big of an inconvenience. But I just want to point out, you know, times are strange, and you'd be amazed. Amazed at that one, but there it is.
Yeah, so some of the pictures of the shipping, the Los Angeles port where it had the Connex boxes just lined up.
Oh, you can Google it. Yeah, it's crazy.
And that just that shipping slowdown affected everything from the fire sauces at Taco Bell to the pizza boxes at the pizza restaurant.
Yeah.
So you wouldn't think, yeah, okay, our ice cream made it there because it's flown over, but the ice cream cones that you want to have for your kids didn't make it to the
I know. You may have to use a bowl. All right, here's traffic safety and traffic court. My concern is the drop-off location at Sullivan Students in front of Shobu Heights. There are so many kids and parents that walk through the back cul-de-sac by Shobu Heights to get to the school. There's a line of cars turning around there. Parking lot is unsafe. There are 20, 25 cars daily that race through there. Yeah, you better be careful because, you know, we will give you tickets. Signs are posted everywhere, but they will get ticketed, but I've yet to see security issue any tickets. Well, that's because sometimes I have my plainclothes people that write your number down and then give you tickets later. So the schools and traffic, for whatever reason, there's a culture of noncompliance, which I find irritating. to say the least. And so we've directed a change to our traffic, or actually the security instruction. I'm going to double down on your points on your license, just like in a work zone. So which means one moving violation and one traffic violation, and you'll lose your license, right? Because you're going to get, moving violations, normally 4. That'll be 8 points. Parking violations, normally 2. That'll be 4. That's 4 points. 12 points in a 12-month period, you lose your license. And then it's amazing. People always ask for it back. And the justification is something like, well, it's hard for me to get to work now. Well, yeah, then you shouldn't have broken the rules. But please be nice out there. Please follow the rules. We've actually had people swear at the little kids that are helping to direct traffic. And I will not tolerate that. In fact, my 10-year-old has recently become part of the kids' safety patrol. And I'm not sure if the school intentionally did that, but he's thrilled about it. And if you think I'm a rule follower, I got nothing on Brendan, my 10-year-old. Like, I often say, I'm an A-type personality. If there's a letter before A, that's the personality he would have. So he will have no problem writing your name down and writing your ticket down, which is very funny. But, be polite. Don't break the rules. It's all about safety. It's all about the kids. What example are you setting to your kids when you swear at a teacher as you're taking them to class? I told the schools I would just suspend the kid and tell them you can just welcome the wonderful world of homeschooling. There's a lot of folks who do that successfully. There you go. So anyway.
Thing I saw in here was the drop-off location of Sullivan School at Shoba Heights. I didn't even realize that was a drop-off location.
I'm pretty sure. We may want to double-check that, and you may find it's not. So these de facto locations, follow the rules. There are rules. They are not in parking lots at these things. And, if I could put speed strips and spike everybody's tires out there, if this is a force protection issue, if I thought that was you getting too close to a building, we would do that. The fact that it's a school, we are trying to be out there and do this stuff, and people not following the rules, you may be walking your kids to school.
Every morning I'm parking myself in the garage right there by the Sullivans.
Not hard.
Kindergarten and my fifth grader, and just hand walking them right over. It's not that difficult.
Yeah, there's plenty of, park over the next parking lot as well. Two crosswalks and you're there, easy, right? Okay, here's another vehicle registration office one. Actually, I find this interesting. So one of the things we're looking at is creating a parking category for non-main base residents, which means if you live in a Kago or you live off base, these are areas that you can park and people that live on base cannot park. Why? I have a presumption that it's easier for you to get where you're going if you already live here. So I'm not sure how this came up because it hasn't been official yet. So, and no one left their contact information. So I think it's an inside person who's somehow complaining about this. From someone from my own vehicle registration office or something. I don't know. How would anyone else know? There's a mole. Actually, I talked about this at the base support meeting, so it could be one of the 10 commands. Regarding the non-main base resident parking policy, they even got the name right, which we're still coming up with that. Married sailors are required to live on base. Based on how senior you are, it's true. We are authorized to have a vehicle. Now you're telling us we can't park on the pier? Well, I think on the pier is a misnomer because you can never park on the pier. But I know what you mean by the waterfront. This is absurd and seems like discrimination. Actually, it is discrimination. It's not discrimination. It's martial law. Okay. Off-base residents. This is the part that I find stunning. I think we should put these two in sumo suits and have them hanging out. Yeah. Off-base residents can easily take public transportation to the base, then walk to the pier. But instead, you're going to tell on-base residents they can't even drive to work. So you're telling me that you expect the off-base people to take public transportation and walk, like from Chuo Station, and you can't walk 10 minutes from your housing thing to the pier. You gotta be kidding me. I don't even know where to go with this thing. But yeah, that's what I'm telling you. I had the same thing when I lived at Kago. I used to get to work at 6 just to find some place close enough to park. Yeah, how about this? How about you get a ride from your spouse? How about you take the on-base shuttle? How about you walk? People who live off-base. Here's the thing, too. I got a home-to-work bus that I'm not even authorized to run. Well, we are not budgeted for it. We kind of take that out of hide. And because on-base parking is so tight. So, yes, there will be sections near the waterfront that I fully expect if you live on this base, you may walk or take the bus that runs right past it or get a ride. But the fact that you somehow think the off-base people have it easy by only having to walk a mile so you can drive 5 minutes, that is ridiculous, my friend. And no, we're not following your suggestion, that's for sure. don't know.
I mean, it seems there's the point they're
really?
Making about taking public transportation and then walking from the gate. Well, there's public transportation on the base that they could walk from the bus stop to.
The irony.
Yeah.
It's an ironic statement that you say, hey, off-base people, they can take public transportation. So can you. So can you.
And I don't think there's many places on the base where you can't walk from point A to point B.
Not a big base. I like to tell people it's huge. All the people back in Conus, how big we are. But the fact of the matter is, you know, it is not a long walk.
If you
really
think the space is big, go take a trip up to Yokosuka and go over to the east side and try to walk over to the west side. Sometime.
So even, I actually measured this out because we had a bunch of Japanese scouts that walked through the base. It's about 2.5 kilometers from the main gate down to the Yokosuka Middle School, right by the water, right? And if you're cutting through, so it's not far anywhere you go. Let's see. So, and again, it talks about, you know, GOVs, POVs, yes. So Fleet Activities 5800.2 Golf talks about, you know, we have to promote efficient and safe operations in the traffic environment, and parking of GOVs and POVs must be tightly regulated. That's what it says, and that's what we're doing. So we're trying to make it easier on people who live off base because, you know, you have a spot to park your car, park it in your driveway, right? Park it outside in the designated spot and leave some room for everyone else on base. Here we go. Here's some good news. Club T, Club Takamiya out there to Keigo. Staff is wonderful, always a smile for the guests, and the manager goes above and beyond to make experience a pleasant one. Some food needs improvement. Good comments. So I've worked in small places. I used to work in a deli in New York. And the more business you have, the more risk you can take in different food types and things, because you assume like a 10% throwaway type stuff. So when you have a lot of turnover, you can actually take risk and try new specials. That's what your specials are at your restaurants. You're going to see who likes it. So the more people who move out there, the more people who use it, food is going to improve. So, but we take that on board. Please feel free to make suggestions, and they'll know at least one person will buy it.
Yeah, I mean, that goes back to my comment I made earlier in the show about that. Develop that personal relationship with the chefs or the people there, because I have a favorite Indian restaurant off base, and they know us. When my family comes in, they know us by name, and they know what we're going to order, and our food is always consistently good. So it just helps. You take the time to tell that person. You never know. You might make that person's day, and all of a sudden, next time you come in there, you might get extra bread.
Extra naan bread. Garlic naan or something. Your Indian restaurant. That's right. Here's another one for Club Takamiya. So happy that tea time is available in Keigo. So tea time, of course, Club Takamiya. It's kind of like a breakfast type of coffee type of thing we have started up. And people have been asking for it, and so here we came through. This is something I've been asking for years. I now live off base and was so happy on Tuesday to be able to put gas in my car, because we have a gas station right across the street from Club Takamiya, and grab some breakfast before hitting the road without having to go all the way to Yokosuka. So I think tea time is going to be a huge asset to Keigo. So I hope so. So when I went out there for a town hall meeting, and I have some friends out there, and I go to Club Takamiya sometimes on weekends because I camp out there, and sometimes I'm just done with camp food and could use, you know, an omelet. But people have actually mentioned to me and mentioned in other ice comments, you'd love to have a breakfast, kind of a coffee thing. Drop the kids off at school, maybe take the strollers back, just have a little kind of community thing. So there's another comment on that one. Hope the morning cafe stays in effect. Keigo needs the service. I do enjoy the sweet tea, but my favorite drink is chai tea. Maybe that could be added to the menu. To your point, a positive, constructive thing. Manager, we gave him the kudos, and the options are discussed as we move forward. So there you go. So for those of you who live at Keigo, don't know that's out there. That's out there now. So when they're open in the mornings for a couple hours before they shift on to lunch. So good stuff. Let's see here. There was a comment in here regarding unethical practice at human resources. And so I just want to make this a general statement. There's a whole lot of stuff. And, you know, when you apply for a position, you don't get it. There's a little bit of bitterness. It's like getting cut from the team or something like that. So this is not going to go after the human resources thing. I would like to point out that, you know, there is a process. Actually, HRO is not really run by the base. It's actually kind of a larger construct for the region. And then there's a piece of it back in Conus. But the key in all these things, you're saying, hey, you didn't know about the requirements for the job. USAjobs.gov and OPM.gov, Office of Personnel Management, all these things are generally managed centrally. You should know what you're going for. You should know the requirements, and you should be able to gear yourself and present yourself knowing those requirements are.
Yeah, as a civilian employee here for the Navy, and I retired out of the Navy in 2012, and getting into and looking at USA Jobs, I became a real USA Jobs Ranger as I was going through figuring out that the San Diego jobs were handled by HR in San Diego, and ones were handled by DC, and some were different, and then don't even get me started with agriculture and Army and all those other ones.
Well, yes.
So, yeah, it definitely pays to pay attention to the actual job description and requirements, and it doesn't hurt also to sometimes call up that HRO number that's on the job advertisement and following up on those things. So those things are, a lot of times you can kind of put the bug in your ear, and sometimes it helped me out. Sometimes I think I just annoyed them more than I should have, but
you're a better man for it. You're now wiser. Now you're helping other people, which is good. Okay, helping other people. But go to the source. Even though you have someone squared away, sharp like Jim, who knows the information, then you still have to kind of go out there yourself. Well, we always say, hey, you may get the right answer on Facebook 75% of the time, and you'll be exceptionally disappointed that 25% of the time when you get the wrong answer. So the best thing you can, just like Wikipedia, right? A lot of kids use Wikipedia as a reference for their homework. The best thing you can do is get the summary and then go right down to the references that someone else uses and go to the source, make sure that someone isn't just crazy making it up. But I did want to point out also, in addition to some other jobs that are occasionally out there, the next Navy Exchange system has jobs you can apply for, and you will have priority preference when you transfer. Like you say, you go to San Diego, want to get a job there, you get it put into the system there. There is Child Youth Programs has job openings. We are always looking for people. And the taxis, the base taxis, have employment opportunities. There are employment opportunities out here for you in addition to creating your own. So that stuff is out there. So please take advantage of that. I've only got a few minutes here. AmeriCable. I knew we'd gone. Almost gone. Almost made it. I know this is not the States, where we are paying far too much for very slow and spotty service, especially when the regular internet companies in Japan are so much faster. I agree. Just because some of you may be new for some reason. I don't control AmeriCable. It is a private company, and they don't have an exclusive contract, but they're the only game in town right now. And Navy Region Japan is looking at across all Japan. So when AmeriCable came in here many, many years ago, and they got this long-term contract, there was no one envisioned streaming as a capability. And yes, out in town, you get things a lot better. Again, we mentioned the MiFi type of MiFi walkers, all these other types of devices. They also run slower on base because of the LTE antennas that we don't have on base, the coverage, because the base is kind of like a big three-way wedge because the mountain in it and coverage and things like that. But we are looking at options, Boingo and some others coming. But I agree with you, AmeriCable. I wish they offer up to 40 megabits. I wish I could offer up to the $100 where they charge me and say, hey, I'll pay you up to that, basically. But that's not how it works.
When AmeriCable first came here, Netflix was all just DVDs through the mail, and you had
to wait
3 days.
That's right.
There was no such thing as, downloading the latest episode of.
You're talking several gigabytes over the course of an hour and a half of an HD movie that you're now streaming, which no one envisioned that thing. So, yes, I agree. Things are better out in town, absurdly better. And we are trying to make things better for you. And we are going to keep pressing on that, but we can't press AmeriCable. We're going to press for other options to AmeriCable. And here's one. I think it's my last comment, so we'll wrap this thing up pretty much on time. I'm aware, this is for the Purdy Fitness Center. It also goes to my jobs comment. I'm aware there is a child watch program here, but the hours are very limited, and there's not much of a facility for it. I used to go to a gym that you paid a monthly membership fee to, and that included 2 hours of child care a day. I would love to see something like that here. And the comments go on and talk about other things and special fitness machines. And so a lot of those have been addressed to the individual as well. And I guess the overall response is that we agree with you. The program would be awesome and would be unprecedented for a military facility. Well, I don't know if it would be unprecedented. There's a lot of facilities out there. I will tell you, having been to the Pentagon, that is like the only military facility you have to pay to use. You got to join the Pentagon Athletic Club. Yeah, you do. And probably because we have a lot of contractors and we have a lot of civilians that, in order to judge who can use it, who can't, everyone pays. Even take the PRT. You got to pay to take the PRT. Believe that? Yeah, you do. I suppose you could run outside, but it gets pretty cold in that wintertime PRT. So this program would be awesome. It sounds like the Lifetime Fitness that I used to work at, this is our response to you. We would essentially need to have another CDC or SAC center within the Party Fitness Center, but the requirements for a military child care center would make that unfeasible, I guess, is the way we'll phrase this thing. On another note, and this is where we're shifting notes here. So, yeah, we'd like to do that, but to do a full-time child care, we would actually have to have a daycare and certified and everything else. And as you know, daycare, we're trying to improve that, make that larger, more spots as we go along here. And we do want to do that. We do have some machines. We have an area where you watch your own child. I'm a big fan of, like, pairing up with a friend, a couple of friends. Maybe you watch their kids, they work out, and vice versa. We all work out together. And yeah, I would love to do that. I just don't have the space because I have to take it away from something else and then the people. But on another note, if you know anyone who wants a job in the child youth programs or anywhere in MWR, we have a lot available right now. So if you go to mwryokosuka.files. Well, I'm not even going to do this one. All right. Google it. We can. We'll put it on the screen. This is like, yeah, no one's going to type this thing. But if you go to MWR WordPress and you look, there's job opportunities on there. You can find all these jobs. So child youth programs, and we'll get you in touch with that. The more people we have working in child youth programs, the better we can supplement our fitness centers with extra programs like the Child Watch. And the staff who does the Child Watch program actually comes over from school-age care. So it's all part and parcel of that. We do need more people. We need more child development homes. But there are jobs out there. People are always concerned about working when they come over here, being able to have an opportunity. You can create your own business. And a lot of times we try and give you a path to yes. Can't compete with the next. But hey, if you want to cut hair, if you're willing to go on someone else's site, that's something the next doesn't do. Right? So we'll say yes. And catering and all kinds of things that people do. But also, like we said, the NEX has a whole program. You're entering into a company, and you will be able to keep that everywhere you go. You can continue. You won't reset. You get 2 years or 3 years experience here. You go over to Norfolk, you can get two or three more. And you keep in that system. Accumulates up. Like you're working for the Home Depot and transferring everywhere you go. The base taxis, if you just want part-time. And the next, you can do part-time for an hour a week if you want. Just to pad your resume and say, hey, I did work while I was overseas in Japan. And child youth programs, it's great stuff, especially if you like to, it's like getting paid, but you're same kind of volunteer quality of giving back to the kids and taking care of kids and stuff like that.
And that's one of the things, go back to the civilian employment opportunities as well. When you're on the USA Jobs, it actually has lines there saying, you know, if you have this experience, you have some kind of volunteer experience that would equal up or qualify for doing stuff. So there's those availabilities and those opportunities are available on the base here and use for people to do.
Yeah. Good stuff. So with that, I think we'll say adios. Couple last things. Again, Spring Festival, the 29th of March. Vehicle registration, it's due in June. We're going to have the road tax roadshow, coming up next week at the Fleet Theater, where you can go there. We'll have the computers there. We'll have people from the city there to help you get all that stuff done. And also register for school. Even if you're in school now, you have to re-register. We got to get those numbers up so we know how many teachers to hire for next year. But you want to take care of that. So register for your schools, all of you with school-age kids. Register your vehicles coming up, and hopefully we'll see you at the Spring Festival.
Sayonara.
Take care.